Hey everybody, thanks for watching. I'm Zach Peterson, I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're gonna talk about thermal resistance for your components and your PCB. Now, thermal resistance is one of those things that I think is misunderstood and not really used enough. Using the thermal resistance value for your components is a good way to figure out just about what temperature they might be running at when your board is in operation. And it's a really simple value. You can find it in the data sheet. You don't really need to calculate much and you'll be able to get this estimate. Overstressing your components is something that happens sometimes by mistake. And I think it's something that people don't really take into account when they're doing their designs. Just by looking up this value in your data sheet, you'll know what power you can dissipate over a component, how high current you can run it, all these different issues that sometimes people just guess at. So that's what we're gonna be talking about today. Let's get started. First, let's look at what exactly is thermal resistance. Again, I think this is something that is really misunderstood, and it has a really simple analog to the way regular resistors work in an electronic circuit, which is one of the reasons that it's called thermal resistance. So let's just say that I have my circuit board. This is just a side view, and I've got a component mounted on the top of it. So here's my component. And what the thermal resistance describes is how fast or how easily heat can dissipate away from this component. Now, thermal resistance is a unique value for every component. If I had an identical component made of different materials, let's say like identical in size and shape, but different materials, it would have a different thermal resistance value. Flip that around, I could take two different size and shape components made from the exact same materials, and they will have different thermal resistance values. So thermal resistance is a component-specific metric, and you have to get it from a data sheet. Most data sheets for most components will have it, as long as the data sheet is reasonably thorough. The big manufacturers are really good about testing this and measuring it and making sure that there is a very accurate value in the data sheets. What the thermal resistance describes is essentially when I have some temperature difference between the temperature of my component and the temperature of the environment, let's just say air in this case, it tells you what the temperature change is, delta T, per unit of power that the component dissipates. So we're going to call it delta T over P, so change in temperature for unit of power. So thermal resistance, RT, is in units of, normally, degrees Celsius per watt. This is a very simple calculation. As long as I know the power that this component is dissipating in watts, I can calculate essentially what its temperature rise is. Sounds simple, right? Now, you have to be careful here because thermal resistance is quantified in specific situations. So it can be quantified between the package, meaning the outside of the component, the package, and ambient or air. And so what it's really telling you is what the temperature difference is going to be between the package surface and air for a given power dissipation. Now, if you know that and you know the power you're dissipating, you can calculate what the temperature should be with respect to ambient. So just as a quick example, okay? Let's say we have a component where RT is 5 degrees C per watts. And let's just say that this component is dissipating 6 watts of power. Well, RT times 6, it gives me 30 degrees Celsius. Pretty simple, right? So what this says is that this component is going to be 30 degrees hotter than whatever the temperature of the air is. So if your ambient temperature goes up, then your component temperature also goes up because this tells you a temperature difference, not an absolute temperature. We know it's not an absolute temperature because let's just say instead of 6 watts, we had 1 watt. Then we'd have RT times 1 here, and we wouldn't have 30, we would have 5. So obviously, if this is air at 20 degrees Celsius and we heat our component up at 1 watt of power dissipation, it's not gonna cool down to 5 degrees C. Instead, it would be 5 degrees above whatever the temperature of air is. So this is a really useful metric because it gives you a way to estimate what the temperature would be of the component while it's operating. Sometimes these values will be described in a little more specificity. It won't just be the component to air. It will be the component between the board and air. Sometimes what you'll see in a data sheet is you'll see the component over copper. So they'll assume that you have a plain layer back here, then air. So what's happening in this situation is the component is dissipating some of its heat through the board into copper. And then it's also dissipating some of its heat directly into the surrounding air. And this measurement or this value of the thermal resistance that they give you will tell you in this specific situation what the temperature rise can be expected. Some typical values that you might see on a data sheet. Normally when they give you a typical value for a component mounted on a circuit board with, let's say, you know, some a copper plane, just as an example, they're generally assuming that this is a typical FR4 grade laminate. And then for the copper weight, will also determine how fast heat can be pulled away from the component and then moved elsewhere around the board. So generally they're gonna assume 1 ounce per square foot, and they might assume only 1/2 ounce per square foot. Let's just suppose for a moment you had a 2 ounce per square foot plane, you would actually have a smaller thermal resistance because this plane is pulling more heat away from the component. And so it's gonna bring the temperature change down a little bit. So some typical values that you might see in the data sheet, let's say without a plane, so package to air might be about 30 degrees Celsius per watt. With a plane or with copper nearby, you might have something smaller, maybe 24 or so degrees C per watt. These two values, no matter, well, really any thermal resistance value, what they're assuming in this power value is that this is all resistive power drop. This is not reactive power drop. So they're only counting the power consumption in a component that is dissipated as heat. So that's really important. Let's say that you had just a capacitor and you calculated the reactive power that's being stored and released by that capacitor. Let's say it's being driven with an AC signal. That reactive power doesn't actually contribute to any resistive heat or any resistive losses. And so because of that, that portion of the power won't generate any heat. You could only count the portion of the total power consumed by a component that is accumulated as resistive losses. And that's what's going to determine the temperature rise in the component. What else can we do to maybe get these heat or these heat thermal resistance values down lower? If you said anything about where's my heat sink on here, you would be exactly right. So if we have a heat sink up here, very messy heat sink, but still a heat sink nonetheless. If we have our heat sink up here, now we have another big piece of metal that has very high thermal conductivity. And that is going to produce a lower thermal resistance. And so what happens is heat gets pulled into the component, into the heat sink, I should say. And then it generally flows up through these spines very quickly. And this is essentially like having a chimney effect on top of your heat sink. And one of the reasons that heat sinks use these large fins like this is so that they can have a very large surface area around the top side of the heat sink. Having that large surface area allows air to flow through. So let's say you have a fan blowing air through. You can have forced airflow that pulls heat off of the component through this surface. Having that large area also allows heat to just naturally dissipate into surrounding air, even if there is no forced airflow. And this then will help reduce that thermal resistance of your component. To actually figure out what that value is, you may need to do some simulations. You may need to actually consult with the heat sink maker to see what sorts of values they expect to see. Some heat sinks are developed for specific components, so they can tell you for certain components what they would expect. The other thing that you can do is you can just build a test board or just buy a component and put a heat sink on it, power it up, and just measure it and see what you get. And you can compare the two. And that'll tell you how much or how big of a reduction in the thermal resistance you might see for that component by adding a heat sink. So one thing that happens with heat sinks and in order to attach them onto the component is you have to actually add a little interface here. So you add some adhesive. And this adhesive is thermally conductive. And this adhesive also helps pull heat off of the component and into the heat sink. So these thermal interface materials are very important for attaching heat sinks to components. They provide adhesive effect, but they also provide a very nice uniform interface here to pull heat off of the component and into the heat sink. So if you have a component, you know it's going to run hot, and you know that you're going to need some assistance from cooling beyond just natural convection or even forced airflow, heat sink, thermal interface material, and then on the PCB, if you run copper below that component, there will be a area for heat to dissipate into, and that copper will pull heat around the board and away from this hot component. So this is everything that you need to know about thermal resistance. And hopefully, when you look up in your data sheet and you see this thermal resistance value, there's a bit more context to understand what it means and how to use it. Okay, everybody, thanks for watching. Help us hack that YouTube algorithm, hit the like button, hit the subscribe button. If you have comments, leave them in the comments section. If there's any content that you want to see on this channel, please, we love to hear your questions. Leave them in the comments. We'll try to get to everything because I do get a lot of questions on my LinkedIn and on YouTube, and we'll make sure to make a video about it. Also, if you're looking for a great PCB design software application to get started with new designs, Circuit Maker is a great choice. Circuit Maker right now is free to use, and everybody that uses Circuit Maker will have access to a complete set of design tools for taking an idea just from a drawing on paper through schematics, PCB layout, and you can really easily generate all the files that you need for manufacturing. It's a great tool to use to learn about the concepts and practice of PCB design before you move on to a more advanced program like Altium Designer. There's a link in the description below. You can go check out Circuit Maker. There's also some related articles you can go and read that'll help you learn more about thermal issues in your PCB. Thanks again for watching, everybody. Hope you enjoyed this video. Stay tuned for more, and don't forget to call your fabricator.